Hello and welcome back to Psych Ed. Today's video is going to be going over the imposter syndrome. First described in 1978 by the researchers Clance and Imms in their paper The Imposter Phenomenon in High-Achieving Women, Dynamics and Therapeutic Intervention as an internal experience of intellectual phonies. Researchers now estimate that about 70% of people around the world suffer from imposter syndrome at one point or another. So what exactly is imposter syndrome? Some telltale signs might be agonizing over even the smallest mistakes or flaws in your work, attributing your success to luck or outside factors, being sensitive to even very constructive criticism, and downplaying your own expertise in areas where you are genuinely more skilled than others. While the initial paper, authored by Clance and Imms, titled The Imposter Phenomenon in High-Achieving Women, Dynamics and Therapeutic Interventions, theorized that women were uniquely affected by imposter syndrome, more recent research has shown that both men and women experience imposter feelings. Indeed, Clance later published a paper acknowledging that imposter syndrome is not limited to women. And today, imposter syndrome can apply to anyone who isn't able to internalize and own their successes. There's not just one type of imposter, in quotation marks. There are several types of imposters. For instance, one of these is the perfectionist, who set extremely high expectations for themselves, and even if they meet 99% of their goals, but not the remaining 1%, they're going to feel like failures. Any small mistake for a perfectionist will make them question their own competence. Another type of imposter is the expert, who feel the need to know every piece of information before they start a project and constantly look for new certifications or trainings to improve their skills. They won't apply for a job if they don't meet every single one of the criteria listed, and they might be hesitant to ask a question in class or speak up in a meeting at work because they're afraid of looking stupid if they don't already know the answer. Another type of imposter is what's called as the natural genius. So when the natural genius, again in quotation marks, has to struggle or work hard to accomplish something, they think this means that they aren't good enough. They are used to skills coming easily, and when they have to put in effort, their brain tells them that's proof that they're an imposter. Another type of imposter is the soloist, and the soloists feel that they have to accomplish tasks on their own, and if they need to ask for help, this makes them a fraud or a failure. Last category of imposter that I'm going to be talking about is the superman or the superwoman. And these are individuals who push themselves to work harder than those around them to prove that they're not imposters. They feel the need to succeed in all aspects of life, at work, as parents, as partners, and they may feel stressed when they are not accomplishing something new. So, what causes an individual to have these feelings of being an imposter? So remember, a syndrome is a multitude of ailments, not just a single one. Research suggests that personality traits largely drive imposter syndrome. Those who experience it struggle with self-efficacy, perfectionism, as well as neuroticism. Many people who feel like imposters grew up in families that place a large emphasis on achievement. In particular, parents who send mixed messages, alternating between overpraise and harsh criticism, can increase the risk of future fraudulent feelings. So moving away from individual predictors of imposter syndrome, at the societal level, research suggests that an individual's position in the social hierarchy can play an important role in shaping his or her imposter feelings. Groups in society that are often linked to the imposter syndrome, particularly women and minority groups, are also subject to persistent negative stereotyping. For example, because of the stereotype of the good leader possessing predominantly masculine traits, women are often depicted as lacking leadership qualities. For instance, they are stereotypically perceived as being communal, warm, and maternal, while men are portrayed as having a more natural fit for leadership positions. i.e. they are stereotypically perceived as being able to express agency and being assertive. In response to these gender and leader stereotypes, research suggests that a woman may feel insecure and out of place if she were to achieve such a leadership position, as these pervasive stereotypes have consistently signaled, both directly and indirectly, that she would not be fit for such a position, and that there are other male colleagues who would be a better fit. In addition, there is a more immediate institutional context where certain genders are more represented in certain roles. For instance, women are more likely to be underrepresented in a surgery position, but overrepresented in a nursing position. Likewise, women are underrepresented in IT, but are overrepresented in human resources. And thus, when there is somebody who breaks away from these stereotypes and representations, they may feel that they don't really deserve to be in this different or this underrepresented position. So research suggests that a lack of representation, as well as lower compensation, elicit doubts about one's suitability for these occupations and positions. This line of research therefore suggests that institutional structures may cause these individuals to question their place within certain institutions, thereby increasing the susceptibility to feel like imposters when in these positions and institutions. Finally, at the interpersonal level, social psychological research suggests that how people are treated by self-relevant others is an important precursor to imposter feelings. This is because an individual's everyday interactions are laced with important social evaluative cues, conveying whether others see them as a person of value and worth or not. These social evaluative cues ultimately guide individuals' appraisals of their own self-worth, and thus shape their self-esteem and sense of being worthy or deserving of their place within that group or context. Thus, to fully understand individuals' imposter feelings, this research suggests that it is key to consider the quality of treatment people receive from others, i.e. the social evaluative cues, particularly the type of treatment that communicates a sense of value, worth, and fit. In this regard, research contends that individuals may very well feel like imposters when they are treated in ways to suggest that they are imposters. Similarly, such imposter feelings can also be mitigated when these individuals are treated by others as a person of value. So this leads us on to overcoming imposter syndrome. So how do we overcome this feeling that we don't deserve to be where we are, and that we got through some reason or the other that's not based on our own individual skill level? So, first and foremost, overcoming imposter syndrome involves changing our mindset about our own abilities. Imposters feel that they don't belong, so acknowledging their expertise and accomplishment is key, as is reminding themselves that they earn their place in their environment, whether it be academic, professional, or social. People should stay focused on measuring their own achievements instead of comparing themselves with others. Similar to perfectionists, people with imposterism, as it's called, often put a lot of pressure on themselves to complete every task flawlessly. They fear that any mistake will reveal to others that they aren't good enough or aren't smart enough for their job. In certain situations, turning to a colleague or mentor who understands one's feelings of insecurity can be beneficial. Research suggests that reaching out to people outside of one's academic or professional circle may be a better tool to combat imposterism. Those individuals can put the person's concerns into context, recalibrate their perspective, and offer support. Additionally, you need to separate facts from feelings. Chances are you'll feel imposter syndrome creeping in at some point in your life. Research suggests that we need to be ready for those feelings, observe them, be mindful of them, and be ready with a response. Recognize that just because you think these things, it does not make them true. And to help with this is take note of your accomplishments. In moments where you feel less than, it can be helpful to have a tangible reminder of your successes. As mentioned before, we need to stop comparing ourselves with others and compare ourselves with ourselves. Focus on measuring your own achievements instead of holding them up against others. Comparing your own life to a carefully curated influencer's social media feed, for example, is a trap of feeling like you don't measure up. Indeed, the rise of social media and technology in general constantly forces us to compare ourselves with others. And even though we know at some level that what's being shown to us is not the full story, only the best parts of these individuals' lives, we still feel that we are less than. And lastly, talk to others. Sometimes a good chat with somebody who knows you and supports you can help you realize that your feelings of imposterism are normal, but also irrational. We deserve to be where we are because we worked hard for it. And that's all for this video. I hope you found it interesting. And if you do, maybe consider dropping a like and subscribing to the channel. Also, drop a comment. Let me know if you felt some imposterism at some time, or you know somebody who has. And I know I personally have. I'll be interested to read your experiences. Anyway, that's all for now. I hope you enjoyed the video, found it interesting, and I hope to see you all the next one.